over the heels we go?
Welcome to BYOD. So, Andy, what are you doing for the holidays?
Gonna work on my Christmas carols because we were gonna sing to open the show and I can't even remember the words. So clearly I need to brush up by Sunday. The holidays, we're gonna catch up on our photo albums, we're gonna spend time with our family, we're gonna see all the friends we never saw all year, we're gonna, you know, and then it's like a week.
Yeah.
You know, and it happens to be this week, so I think I'm spending the week in the studio with you.
Oh, well, I was thinking about going to Hawaii.
You're gonna go to Hawaii?
Maybe not.
Are you gonna come over?
Sure.
You wanna come over?
Yeah.
Because on Christmas night, what we're going to do is light the Hanukkah candles.
Okay.
Get some Chinese food out.
Watch docs.
And then, let's watch some documentaries.
Let's
decide what we want to watch today.
Sounds like a plan.
I have an idea. Why don't we have a special guest on to kind of advise us? Somebody who knows a lot about documentaries.
That sounds like a plan.
So today's episode, everybody, is going to be about the best docs of the year. It's our year-end roundup. You can tell because we have our decorations here. And I forgot my menorah. I'm a bad Jew today. But I do. I am the kind of Jew that has a Christmas tree as well and a Kwanzaa bush. So at any rate, we're going to talk about the good, the bad, and the ugly in documentary and also have on a really, really cool guy. I don't want to give it away till after the, you know, totally flashy and pizzazzy opening that we have for this show, which will sort of hint at it. So let's cut to that, but we're gonna have this guy on who's rad. All right,
welcome
that was
back.
Pretty snazzy. To help us determine the best films of 2011, I thought that I would invite my friend AJ Schnack down, not only to find out where his name came from, because that could take up an hour-long show, I'm sure, but also because he will he's written this blog called All These Wonderful Things. For many, many years, and has sort of become the guy who's in the know in the documentary world, and behind the scenes, in front, if you want to know who got shortlisted from the Oscars before anybody else, including the New York Times knows, AJ Schnack knows that information. So without further ado, as well as he's a award-winning filmmaker in his own right, made a very, very depressing film you may have heard of called Kurt Cobain, About a Son, which we will look at the trailer for and talk to him a little bit about filmmaking as well, because I think he's doing that more than ever right now. So AJ, come on out. AJ.
So there should be like a musical number or something.
Fist bump.
Yeah.
Well, how are you doing?
We should kiss,
right? Okay, a hug and a kiss.
Oh.
I'm good. I feel festive.
Glad it's been ages.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
I have my mother's red bell bottoms on today.
I noticed.
From back in the 60s.
I yeah. noticed. I hope you wear them all through the holidays.
I'm planning to. Yeah, I'm just not going to sweat at all. Or find a dry cleaner open on Christmas. Something. Before Vlad comes over.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Just keep wearing them until they can walk on their own.
What are you going to do for the holidays?
Well, it's a little bit of a break, and then I go back to work right after Christmas. So it's nice to take a little bit of a breath and then go back to making a new film. And
that's cool.
But
you were in Iowa, I believe,
yeah.
When I contacted you.
I was in Iowa.
I've spent some good time in Iowa myself recently.
Iowa's an amazing place.
It's an amazing place.
What part of Iowa were you in?
I was in Des Moines, and then I drove out to Council Bluff, and then I drove all the way up to
Sioux City,
yeah. Which is like one of the hearts of conservatism in America. You're there, I'm sure, covering politics.
Let me just say about Sioux City, though, is when we were there, folks were telling us it was the most conservative place in Iowa. And they were telling us this in a bar where the bartender was taking her top off. So I'm not sure what conservative...
But that is part of conservatism. Yeah, hypocrisy is part of the core elements of conservatism.
Well, this was a very interesting scene. being in Sioux City. I actually was spent a bunch of time all over Iowa, and it's an amazing town.
I'd done that L, you know, straight out and then up, and the wind storms and the rain storms, and
it was very windy. Well, you know, they have all the.
And then you go into the wrong Sioux City because there's three Sioux Cities, and you never know. Right there, they're all right there.
There's Sioux Center. There's
Sioux everything.
There's South
and no Sioux,
North Sioux,
and yet the Sioux are not there.
Well, yeah,
it's all white people.
What are you gonna do?
What I did was infiltrate the religious right, which I should talk to you about that because maybe I want some tips, connections.
We should, well, and vice versa.
Well, are you covering the Republicans doing their thing, or
yes,
what are you doing?
Yeah, we're making a film about the Republican candidates for president. So. We're in the home stretch. We have they have 2 weeks. I'm taking a week off, but then I'll have about 10 days at the end of their process in Iowa.
What have you learned thus far? Can you give us a little insider tip that can be live on the internet and yet at the same time not get you in trouble, but inform
our viewers? It's been a fascinating process. I mean, I'm actually a big fan of the caucuses. Not everyone is. Not everyone thinks that Iowa or New Hampshire and South Carolina should have this large role in determining who the nominees are, but people take it so seriously. You know, you can go to a small town, literally almost in the middle of nowhere, and you know, 50, 60, 70 people will turn out who are not decided, who are going to ask tough questions of these candidates, and actually put them through a process that is in many ways better than what the national media is doing. So I think it's actually a great thing, and
it's probably
kind of
more personal, right? I mean, it's probably a lot more personal, a lot more about the real needs of the people instead of being filtered through the media.
Well, also, right? it's not just about like whatever the story of the day is or the issue of the day or whatever, you know, might be discussed in Politico. You know, they might not be asking Newt Gingrich about like his lack of ads, for example, which is, you know, what the press is all very focused on, but they might ask very penetrating questions about, you know, what his policy regarding health care is, that isn't being asked, you know, sort of in a national way. And I think that's a kind of a really great thing. And I was
people
really
have just entered the building.
Interesting state. Well, you know, it's busy out there. Well, I think we're in the back lot of a Hardee's.
We are actually.
Right now?
We're in the back.
You're in Beverly Hills, not at 210 right now, and we are in the back lot of Matsuhisu. We are in a back lot, though.
No, we are. It is the back lot.
But you're in the back lot of Hardee's back in Iowa,
is exactly what
you're saying.
Yeah, pretty much.
We've got some people that would probably serve you a nice warm drink at the end of the night, some great lesbians down there that would just hook you up. We should tell you.
In Iowa?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh,
Des
Moines? Des Moines. Yeah.
You know, Des Moines, Des Moines is.
Oh, it's so cool.
Well, it's just like any other like large Midwestern city.
It's a haven.
Yeah. I mean, the people who want that. I mean, Iowa City has a similar kind of vibe. I mean, you know, it's the kind of place where people who want to have an urban culture, but they're in Des Moines for whatever reason, or in Iowa City for whatever reason.
And they don't want to leave.
And they
don't
want to leave.
Iowa rocks.
Yeah, like the prices of homes and of, you know, like you can live.
They have some amazing restored historical homes there.
Yeah, it's a beautiful state. The Midwest is quite beautiful. So,
well, that's cool. That's cool.
There.
And you had made another film about politics called
Convention. Yeah, which was about the Democrats. So this was a way to do the flip side of that.
Okay. Do you have a favorite emerging from all this? It would be terrible for you to say right now, right?
Of the candidates.
Yeah.
Yes, I've interviewed Newt before.
Yeah. Well,
he's quite smooth.
They're all, I mean, like, literally, I won't have a cast of characters as interesting as the group that's running for president on the Republican side ever again in a documentary. So
that's awesome. That's awesome.
Yeah, I mean, that you can't. I mean, how can you go wrong with these like 6 to 8 people, depending on?
Are you directing or co-directing?
Directing. Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
And you're the only one. You don't see like Jahan running around with a camera or Morgan Spurlock's not.
I've galloping
through the town.
No, I have not seen Morgan Spurlock galloping.
That's fantastic.
No, it's great. Yeah.
That's funny. It's ironic because I was making for a while this year a film for HBO about gay marriage.
Yeah.
And I was following Iowa.
Well, yeah, it's a huge issue in Iowa.
It's a huge issue in Iowa because the three Supreme Court justices were ousted. I'm with you. Specifically looking at gay marriage, but you and I would have been sharing some. I found this really good Vietnamese restaurant down there.
A Dong?
Yes. Yeah. A-dong.
A-dong.
I would have been an A-dong.
Yeah. I finally had a-dong in my mouth just the other day.
It's so good.
Lovely.
Yeah, are
lovely.
You so excited?
I'm so excited, yeah. Well, you can't...
It's that or beef.
Well, yeah. Well, I don't eat... yeah, I have
and
the chicken. But you're... You know, it's the kind of thing we joked about for months because it's like you're really not going to go eat at a restaurant called A-dong.
You
but
do.
Then at some point you're like,
first
well, you
stop.
Know what?
It was my first stop. I landed at the airport and I went to
A-dong.
Like,
why the fuck am I not
going to
eat at A-dong?
Right.
Well,
and
what
then,
else am I going to eat?
Right.
Is more the question.
And then you go and it's
delightful. Rather tasty.
With
this sort of
who knew?
Who knew? But only in...
See, if only I'd been talking to you earlier, you would have told me...
I had
me,
no idea you were in Iowa.
This is the great thing
about this show, I've got to say. I've got to thank Michael Lustig and the Lip TV crew for enhancing my life by having me reconnect with friends like AJ live on the internet and discover things like, you know...
A-dong.
A-dong, or rediscover A-dong.
Yeah.
If I'd known, I would have brought some food down for the festive theme, but let's jump right into it, shall
we?
First of all, let's look at your, let's look at something that you've done.
All right.
When did you make About a Son?
I filmed it in 2005 and early 2006, and it premiered it to Toronto in 2006, and then it was in theaters in 2007.
And why did you make this film?
I had been wanting to make it for a long time. I found out that Michael Azarad, who's a well-known music journalist who had written the Nirvana book, Come As You Are, I found out that he had about 25 hours of audio tapes, his interviews with Kurt that he did for the book, that no one had ever heard them before aside from Michael. And just pitched him on an idea of doing something that was really exclusively about those tapes, because having read the book, I knew that they were about a really specific and interesting time in Kurt's life. He was coming out of a lot of the tabloid scandals related to their heroin use and the birth of their daughter. And so a lot of what that was about was, you know, him trying to fight back against all of that bad publicity and people like writing these things about them that he felt was really untrue. So it was his notion that he was going to have Michael come in and then he was going to be able to set the record straight through these interviews. So it would be the sort of the best opportunity to really get Kurt's first person view on what had happened leading up to that time period. And then of course he was dead a little more than a year after the interviews were done.
And before you made the film.
Long before.
Yeah. So you got access
years.
To these interviews.
Yeah.
And then came out with this. Okay.
And then made this film.
And there were several films about Kurt Cobain, but...
There have been, yeah.
Yeah, but this is the one that actually uses the first person tapes.
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, Nick Broomfield's obviously a very talented filmmaker and has made some really great films and has been doing these sort of a series of films about powerful people and his inability to sort of reach them.
Yeah.
And the people who surround them, they're kind of...
One of my favorite of all time, I mean, Nick Broomfield, if you want to brush up on him real quick, Eileen Wuornos' Portrait of a Serial Killer is one of my favorite films of all time.
It's a great
film. And it's
film.
My favorite Nick Broomfield film.
Yeah, and so he makes these films about these really, you know...
Not even getting to her.
Extreme they were like, characters, and then he barely gets to the main character, but it ends up really being about like these weirdos who surround the main character.
Yeah.
And so it's funny because the film is really not that much about Kurt in the end as it is about this sort of relationship between Nick and Courtney and Nick pursuing Courtney, which is similar to his film also about Heidi Fleiss and I guess his new film about Sarah Palin.
And about Eileen Wuornos.
Yeah. So it's interesting. And then of course Gus Van Sant made a film that was kind of about Kurt. So there are these films out there that I mean, a lot of things that sort of dance around the idea of who Kurt was. But I think it was great to be able to make something that was like really, really specifically just his point of view and nobody else like trying to have their say on it.
Is there did you come at this as a fan?
Yeah, well, I'm a music fan. As
were
you know,
a...
we first met, you know, I think at a music party while you were filming Dig.
Is that true?
That's true. Yes, we've had this
what
conversation
are you
so many times. Jesus. So
can we have it one more time?
Yes.
Because I don't remember.
Yes, at their manager Michael's house, Michael Dutcher.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, and you were there shooting.
Yeah.
And it was just some party. I don't know if it was an after party.
Was
after
he in the
show?
Wear white and come when I call phase where he was sort of everything was he was living there and
yeah,
wearing
it was
white.
It was
and,
in the Fatty Arbuckle house or whatever.
Right, it was in that big old house.
Yeah.
Wow. And that's how we met, and we decided.
That's how we met. Well, we just.
But then we didn't see each other for years.
Yeah, we didn't see each other for years. Yeah.
Then when do we re-meet? Since you're Mr. Memory.
Well, that's harder to say. I feel like it was after. Well, certainly after Dig.
I was very impressed with you when I was freezing on the sidewalk in Missouri, and you were. Andy, can I have a word with you, please?
Yeah.
I was trying to get inside somewhere warm, and you were like, let's talk about your movie.
Yeah.
And I was like, AJ, what the heck are you doing out here?
Yeah. Well,
and you were covering the documentary scene.
That's right.
And nobody else was.
Trying to do it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Now I'm a hand off the mantle.
I'm so excited.
To y'all.
Let's look at About a Son.
Cool.
Up until I was about 8 years old, I had an extremely happy childhood. A really good one. I had everything in focus. I knew exactly what I was going to do and nothing could stop me. And I knew that I could do whatever I wanted because the world was really small. And things just happened to lay down before me with luck. And there were no obstacles in my life at that time.
I know that I have to talk about details in my life, but I don't think I'm going to be any more open with my personal life in any other interview in the future. People don't deserve to know, really. I mean, it's none of their business what my personal life is like now. They don't need to know everything about me. I usually am enjoying myself. I'm hardly ever depressed anymore.
I never thought that I'd ever get to that point. Never really tried to do anything scandalous in my life.
It was amazing. It was just like instant success and fame.
I've thought about dying all my life like any normal person.
If I was in that situation with Courtney and Francis, I still, for the rest of my life, would go out of my way to try to have a relationship with her and share things with her, you know, and he just gave up. No matter what we do, how clean we live our lives, we're not going to survive this.
That looks great.
Thank you.
And that looks like a great film to watch over the holidays, too.
Yeah, sure.
So go out and
with
watch
your
this
grandparents,
game.
Yes. Please.
Yes, after Christmas dinner.
I actually just showed it in my hometown, and my mom made me give a disclaimer before the show that there was going to be cursing in it. Because she had invited people from church and then realized that she hadn't told them. And I said, well, never mind the cursing. Do you want to tell everyone that it's all about how he's a big heroin addict? So.
Yeah, but that was not as much of a problem as
the
swearing.
It's
not even called cursing. It's called swearing, isn't
it? Well, I don't know. I think she still says curses.
Oh, does she?
Yeah.
Curses?
Yeah.
have you made your money back on that film? Or like, if people do go and download it, will you make your money back?
No, we'll never make our money back.
No?
No.
Is that not, you don't make docs to make money?
Well, I do. Yeah, I mean, that was a case of, we shot that on film, and, you know, it's probably one of the last times that, I mean, I doubt I'll ever shoot anything on film again. But at the time, HD wasn't good enough in terms of shooting the landscapes that I wanted to do. And, I mean, now we could have made it, I mean, don't tell the producers, but we could have made it for a lot less if it was 3 years later. But we just, you know, you didn't know what technology was coming.
Right.
And at the time, it made sense to shoot on 35mm. So.
And you were able to raise the money. Did you raise money for this film, or are you paying for it yourself, the Republican?
You know, right now, the film I'm making, it's me and a couple of buddies, like,
just
running out. So, you know, we're all happy to just get some food and some
at Adon.
Evening whiskey and
credit card advances.
Yeah, and you know, occasional hotel rooms. So it's
the
okay.
Occasional hotel. I don't even want to hear about that. Speaking of which,
yeah.
Actually, it's a perfect parlay into I was thinking that of all the films that we discussed, the three of us, of what we would cover on this show today, there was one that we all agreed on that was absolutely remarkable.
Sure.
And Vlad, why don't you talk about that? Because he rarely sleeps in hotel rooms, this guy.
This is true. One of my favorite films, and Andy's and AJ's, is a film called Buck. And it's a documentary basically about a cowboy who spends about 40 weeks on the road training people how to ride horses. And really, he's a tortured soul who had a very harsh upbringing and found a piece of his humanity in his relationship with horses.
Would you confirm that?
Yes, I'm sorry. I thought we were going to a clip.
So no, I want
to. We could. Yeah, we could go to a clip.
We could go to the trailer. I just was wondering if you have anything to add.
No, I think it's. I mean, I agree with you. I think the. I mean, comparing it, just since we just finished talking about a son, I think one of the things in our field that people tend not to, which you've made some terrific ones, tend not
donuts?
To sort of value donuts. Yes, are portrait films. Portraits about
sure.
people who are somewhat well known. People tend to think like, oh, that's easy, or you know, biographical sketches, or you know, or maybe it's some subgenre that is not as impressive. But I actually think that you know when they're very difficult to make, and when they're done well, you recognize how few of them there are that are done well.
And well, that's fascinating because what else is there than a great character? I mean, isn't that at the core? I mean, you just said the film you're making right now has some of the best characters you've ever encountered. Isn't it just a pleasure?
It's a total pleasure, but I think that there's a sense sometimes that if it's someone who's well known for being a good character, like Buck is, for example, then it becomes easier for someone to say like, well, anybody could have made him interesting. Anybody could have followed him around with a camera.
Sure.
And I think that when you look at how this film was put together and how it was made, then you see what makes a really outstanding portrait film. And the editing in Buck in particular is really outstanding.
The soundtrack is fantastic. Let's look at the trailer.
When I first seen him, I thought, what kind of voodoo stuff is this, you know? He walks into a round pen and 5 minutes he's got a horse following him around like a dog. Most of us have a bag of tricks. Buck has an arsenal.
I'm looking for the horse to learn how to follow and feel. That's operating on a feel, see? It's supposed to take that much. Everything you do with a horse, it's a dance.
You're always hearing about breaking horses. It's man is stronger than this big animal. We can break them down.
Now I'd touch her here on the neck. I'd say, you find out this flag won't hurt you.
It just blew my mind that it could be done in a way that the horse would cooperate like the people and not be scarred up and afraid for life.
Nobody's here to hurt you.
A lot of times, rather than helping people with horse problems, I'm helping horses with people problems.
This horse tells me quite a bit about you.
In this particular discipline, if you want to be great, you have to be a sensitive person.
That's why so many of the folks that are really good at this are, you know, sometimes they're tortured souls, you know.
They call me Buckshot and I'm 7 years old.
He was just a very ordinary boy. Didn't show signs of early genius.
Thanks, Mom.
It's all I ever wanted to be was a cowboy. I grew up as a trick roper.
My dad beat us unmercifully for not putting on a perfect performance. Horses are my life, and because of some of the things I'd been through as a kid, when something is scared for their life, I understand that.
All your horses are a mirror to your soul. And sometimes you might not like what you see in the mirror.
Watch out!
You can't hold it against him for kind of how his life has been.
Maybe there's some things for you to learn about you. Maybe the horses is going to be the only damn way you're going to learn it.
Yes, I understand that every life must end.
Boy, do you feel like a fool and kind of like a failure.
Oh, it's all right. If you find a way to fit this thing right here, it'll make you better. It'll make you better in areas that you didn't think related to horses.
All right. I think that, I mean, when I watched it, what I felt like was really incredible was not as much that he found his humanity through the horses, but actually that the horses that he understood the horses because of what he'd been through, that somehow he was a horse whisperer because he had to go somewhere very, very deep inside.
Right.
And he knew what it was like to have people ride on him. He knew what it was like to be scared. He knew fear.
Yeah.
Like we don't know fear, you know? But it's such a beautiful film. It's an incredible film, and it has the right balance, I feel like, when it brings in Redford or, you know, his time and, the names. It doesn't feel forced, as I've seen in other work. You know, it's kind of, it's really about him and his daughter and that incredible relationship, too. So we all highly recommend Buck, and hopefully that was enough incentive for you. Is it something that people can go see? I wonder. That's actually our job to tell you. We'll get back to you on that by the end of the show. I'd love to talk about Project Nim.
Oh yeah.
Nim was a chimp, and James Marsh, who directed Nim, actually did Man on Wire, which won the Oscar a couple years ago. AJ would know.
Mm-hmm.
What struck me about this was that he had a really unique way of shooting his interviews in that film as well. And Igor Martinovich shot that film. Man on Wire, and that's a gorgeous film. Aside from the footage, which is incredible, the interviews are shot where he's sitting in this room, and you know the main dude is like crouching down. He's looking up at the camera in these really dramatic interviews. In this film, he did the same thing. When a character would come into the story, the camera would dolly in, stay, and then it would leave as the character left Nim's life. And it really, the story became about a chimp who was taken away from his mother at 2 weeks old. Apparently, this is the sixth baby that the mother chimp loses. I would like to criticize the film for saying that it didn't linger on that. It mentioned it one time, and you don't hear about that again, really, until the very end, and you barely hear about that, but maybe it was enough. Bless you.
Yeah.
In this season.
That's right.
Did you get your flu shot?
I did.
Okay, good. We were very kind of saddened that the mother chimp had lost her baby,
right.
But then the film actually becomes about that. It becomes about these people that enter Nim's life and then leave Nim's life until at the end of it, he's just, he sees his original human mother again, years after he's been too like shocked and brought to a lab. All this crazy stuff happens, and he really approaches her as he knows her. But he's not ready to love her again, and he almost kills her, but he doesn't because he's not going to kill his human mother. It's quite a remarkable story, and it's a very sad story.
Yeah.
Have you seen it?
I haven't seen it.
I recommend it, again, for Christmas.
yeah. Well, it's a very good story about family. You know, I mean, and they bring in Nim as like a member of their family. That's the first family that sort of is adopting him. And then all the people who sort of see Nim as, obviously more than a pet, but like something that they try to feel that they have like it's a great study of people's philosophies and how people think that the way that they've determined is the right way for their situation is absolutely the best way. And it's amazing to see these people decades later, who still think that their approach to Nim was the right approach to Nim, despite all evidence to the contrary
the doctor who
was sleeping with like these various women.
He was sleeping with the students, but that's, I mean,
give Nim to whatever student he was like having an affair with.
Showed up periodically with a camera crew.
Yeah.
I mean, he really didn't care.
No, I mean,
but all the people that he chose who were attracted to Nim, they really cared. And that guy, Bob, who, thank God for Bob in Oklahoma, who's decided, I'm going to be Nim's friend.
Right.
And many of them described it as, it was very selfish. It was like, can I have a solid communication with another species? That was at the core of it.
Right.
Instead of looking at it, and then the emotional bonds began to grow. But once again, we're just spewing on. Watch Nim. Here's a trailer to convince you. Project Nim.
I thought, wouldn't it be exciting to communicate with a chimp and find out what it was thinking? So why not teach him sign language? And that's essentially why I started Project Nim.
knew nothing about chimpanzees. Herb wanted me to take Nim into my home as if he were a child. The fact that we could share language with an animal seemed very radical at that time.
There was no family discussion. It was just, oh, we're having a chimp. We're going to teach a sign language. Nobody in the house really was fluent in sign language.
Everything was about treating him like a human being. He liked alcohol. He loved driving fast in cars. I breastfed him for a couple of months. It seemed completely natural.
I couldn't believe it. It was the 70s.
Herb wanted a schedule and charted progress. I didn't supply that.
There was utter chaos. There were no journals. There were no logbooks. This was a scientific project.
I had an implicit faith that Nim would learn signs.
I just mapped out a teaching plan for Nim, and I did it. Nim was learning signs rapidly. They're going up, 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 up. I could see I was succeeding. There was all this excitement and hype about the project.
I had a relationship with a chimpanzee, and I had conversations with an nth species.
Nim gone from being this meek little huggable toy to a robust young chimpanzee.
He's going to be big, 5 to 6 times the strength of a man.
He's got fangs.
This is 37 stitches.
In that sense, he was becoming more chimp-like. It didn't seem to be a cause for alarm. I had never regarded him as a child. I regarded him as a scientific project. Nobody keeps a chimp for more than 5 years.
I had the best time of my life. I've never had such a good time. Except maybe at a Grateful Dead show.
The reality of it is it's not a doll, it's not a toy, it's not a human, it's a chimp.
All right.
Fascinating.
Pretty cool, huh?
Yeah.
Okay, that was my turn. You've spoken. You have one to recommend.
I love The Interrupters. Steve James' latest film, Steve James, who made Hoop Dreams. It's a terrific and incredibly powerful look at violence interrupters in Chicago, people who in many cases have come out of a gang lifestyle and have at this point now kind of serve in Chicago, which we all know has been incredibly violent over the last many years. Go into situations where they feel that they can help either stop violence from happening, help solve rifts or heal wounds where violence has happened, or just kind of bring down the overall temperature. And it's a really just penetrating look at these individuals who do this, and it's a non-political and yet a very direct look at how this program can work in this society. But it doesn't come in sort of the ways that you'd expect it to come. It's not just liberal in terms of how the program works versus conservative. It upends some of your expectations of politically how the program exists.
What it seemed to me in watching the film was that that really it was people who had experience living in the inner city themselves and who were just fed up with the violence. And so including one woman who had been rolling in it, crack and everything, whose father was one of the major, major pimp gang leaders, heavy, heavy gang leader in Chicago. And she had this incredible gift, almost like Buck with the horses, of stopping fights. And she would just go in there and just cut it. You should see this because you're from Chicago. Have you seen this one yet?
I have not.
All right, maybe we'll put it on for on New Year's or something.
Let's do it.
Yeah, and you were talking about Amina Matthews, and Time Magazine just named her in this film as the fifth best performance in a movie this year. So of course she's sharing that top 10 list. The other nine, none of the other nine are from documentaries. They're all actors.
Oh wow!
So they're talking about just how powerful and unexpected she is, and how she really just like bursts through the screen because you've never seen anything. She's Muslim. She is incredibly tough talking. She you know, is the kind of figure who can walk into a situation where a bunch of young black men are ready to do violence to one another and basically shame them into to stopping the track that they're on. And Steve James, who's always been a terrific filmmaker, but this case shows the power, when we talk about Nim and we talk about some of these other films in which the constructed nature of documentary is heavily on display and the director as auteur is heavily on display, here Steve James shows the power of verite and what it is just to be with a camera in a situation that's about to kind of explode.
Rock on. I love that. Verite.
Indeed.
Let's watch it.
Yeah.
The Interrupters.
I need everybody from the ages of 13 to 24 to stand up. I'ma be real honest with you all because see, we real talking up in here because Duke is real laying right in front of us.
A man was murdered overnight on Chicago's South Side. Police say it happened execution style.
I'm fed up.
124 people have been killed.
Each and every one of you all can be Duke right here.
There are 3 bullet holes in his home fired by...
We got a responsibility to bring our community to be vibrant.
Girl died last Friday, shot in the back as he tried to shoot.
My brothers, cease the fire, call the troops.
The violence of the Interrupters had one goal in mind. Save a life. And we need people to step up to this table and go over and beyond.
Man, we got over 500 years of prison time at this table. That's a lot of wisdom. If I
fall short. Half of my life, I was in prison. That's why I do what I do now.
I think I just stay busy, just try to forget about some of the things that I've done. If your
expectations. I used to be in jails, kicking off riots and just gangbanging.
Let's just correct this. Let's just be a family. There's
always tomorrow. Amina Matthews' father was one of the biggest gang leaders in the history of Chicago. She gets in where a lot of guys can't get in.
Schools, churches, your mama's house, your cars, those are safe zones. Hang in there, baby.
Sooner or later, I'll get it. How can you help me? Right now. How can you help me? Please don't
give up on me. And I thank God that you have changed your life, but you just don't know what they have did to me and my kids. I deal with this every day of my life. I know it's
late. Can't know anybody come in and tell a guy to put his gun down. We've been taught violence. Violence is learned behavior.
If they have a strong person that's lived that life, I think they could be saved. Whatever you
do,
we're gonna make
it. Do you want to be loved? Absolutely. Do you deserve to be loved?
No.
Absolutely.
We're sick and tired of our babies being killed. We can't be quiet no more.
Promise me. We still look out for one another. To me, it's like there's still some hope left.
Don't give up on me.
So, AJ.
Yes, Andy.
What started you and what was the original inspiration in all these wonderful things? I mean, like, why did you start the blog in the first place?
Well, I had made, my first film was about a band called They Might Be Giants. Came out in 2003. And, you know, because They Might Be Giants had such a powerful connection to people on the internet, we knew that we had to reach their fans in a way that would kind of tell them what we were doing. And so at the time, we started a Yahoo group, which now sounds so like almost as if we were like riding in Pony Express. But we had a Yahoo group for that film, and that was a way to kind of connect with fans and get the word out. And so when I was starting About a Son, then it was, the idea was, well, what should I do now? And then, of course, the thing everybody was doing was starting to write blogs. And so I was like, well, I'll write a blog, and I can write about the making of the film, and that'll be a place where people can come for information. And so early on, it was really a little bit about that, and then just kind of random nonsense. And then as it went along, then it became pretty much exclusively about documentaries and nonfiction, and both the films themselves as well as, you know, sort of some of the issues that surrounded it. And I did it for 6 years, and it created some amazing experiences for me. I got to travel to a bunch of places I probably would have never been invited to. But it's 6 years is a long time to do something like that. So.
What about before then? I mean, we have a lot of aspiring filmmakers that watch the show.
Sure.
I mean, how did you get involved with film, and was it a passion of yours as a child, or?
Well, yeah, when I moved to Los Angeles, you know, one of the first things I did is I worked in music videos. So I worked as a PA. I worked as an in-house coordinator at a production company. And then I was 23 and I became an executive producer and started doing a bunch of indie rock videos. And so it made sense why our paths crossed. And so all through the 90s was making music videos. And it kind of became clear at a certain point that that was a dying thing.
Sure.
In terms of what record labels were wanting and what you could give them for the money that they were going to spend.
Right.
We kind of got out of that, and I studied journalism school, so documentaries were something I was always interested in, and obviously my first two films were about music, so it was kind of like those two areas kind of coming together.
Right, right.
What do you think is the music film of the year? I mean, what is the number one sort of must-see 2011 music film?
And it's not a trick question.
Yeah, well,
Tribe Called? Well, you actually edited Tribe Called Quest.
I did some editing on the Tribe Called Quest film, yeah, which is, I think, a terrific film, and Michael Rapaport, it's a really stunning debut for him, I think.
I was on a panel with him, wild guy.
Yeah.
Really.
Wow, the two of you on a panel. That
it was pretty out of control. And it was me and
oh my God, I hesitate to guess who the other person is.
Doug Prey. Held up the rear, really kind of,
the
drummer.
I'm sure Doug kept it all together.
Yeah. Michael and I were like, wah!
He's definitely the drummer. He's the
DJ.
Guy who's like,
love Doug.
Make sure that at the end of the night he actually goes to the club and gets paid.
Yeah, he got us paid that day. He got us paid that day. No, the payment was actually that we got into the graffiti exhibit at MoCA.
Oh, awesome.
And we just got to get a little private tour of that. Yeah. That was our payment.
That's
some
great.
Levi's. And some Levi jeans.
Well, I will say that I think that obviously the biggest music doc of the year and the biggest documentary of the year by a long margin is the Justin Bieber.
Come on.
Never say never.
Come on.
So it clearly
Bieber?
It made far more money. Almost unseated Fahrenheit 9/11 as the highest grossing documentary of all time.
So that's over 100 million.
Yeah, and it's clearly... actually, no.
That's more money than Dig made.
No, probably by 75. Actually, I'm wrong. It didn't get over 100 million.
Okay.
It just beat the Michael Jackson doc, so it's in the 75 million dollars.
Well, that's heartening to know that Fahrenheit would still stand up.
Yeah, well, the film that almost
that's beat... actually incredible.
This is what happens when I don't blog all the time. The film that almost beat Fahrenheit was Jackass 3D. So it does say something
another
about the
very
3D
serious
nature,
documentary.
3D nature of docs being very successful. Cave of Forgotten Dreams was another very successful doc this year. But the Bieber film is much better than it had to be. It is a film that could have just been made on the cheap. Davis Guggenheim at one time was going to direct the Justin Bieber film, but promoting Waiting for Superman apparently got in the way and he had to bow out. So John M. Chu, who had directed, I think, the Step Up 3D films that I'm sure you're all very familiar with, came in to direct it. And it is... it's actually really good.
Does it deal with the pregnancy, untimely fatherhood at the age of 16? Because that's very good doc material.
The alleged pregnancy.
He did take a paternity test.
He did?
He did.
And did he pass?
Of course.
Yeah. Meaning he's the dad?
Meaning he's not the dad.
Yeah. Oh, he's not the dad.
He's not the dad.
Oh, alleged. Yeah. Okay, yeah. That's what that word means. No, I'm just kidding.
And also, that
I
came out like.
I didn't realize that he didn't pass. I'm so sorry to be spreading such terrible rumors on the internet, on the interweb.
Upset about it. There's two things about the film. One is that I always thought in Making About a Son was that we would never see something, what happened with Nirvana or what happened with the Beatles, in that somebody would kind of come out of nowhere and become incredibly world famous in an overnight sensation in kind of way. I kind of felt like, well, maybe we've reached the point where there's no one place that has the eyeballs of an Ed Sullivan show or MTV or whatever that could create that. But
until BYOD.
Exactly. Yes, I hesitate to go out on the streets after the show.
Right.
But and
we can't go anywhere anymore.
Not even, no, we can't. Yeah. We're just pulled off the sidewalks and
exactly.
Stuff. That's why we're staying home for the holidays.
Good. Yeah. The film makes a really, starts off really interestingly in that it basically starts out not with Justin, but with viral videos. and with YouTube videos and how certain ones have become things that we all become part of our pop culture.
Rebecca Black.
That we all
know. Oh, that's
know
how
that
it starts. Okay.
So the film starts out by saying, like, the internet creates these things. And then it goes to this kid, who at the time was probably like, you know, 13. And I didn't know his story. I didn't know that he had put these videos online. Right. I didn't know that this manager in Atlanta had, like, seen these videos and, like, invited him and his mom to come down from Canada and, like, you know, potentially sign with him. So that part of it was all very interesting and an interesting way of doing it. And because they did it in 3D, all of those elements, the way in which viral videos are presented, the way in which Twitter is presented, and then ultimately the way that they used 3D for his performance is the most insane, ridiculous thing, as if two 14-year-old boys got together in a, you know, in a room and maybe got, you know, some of their dad's alcohol and, like, started saying, like, let's make a movie and what would be the most illest shit we can do with 3D. And it is the patently ridiculous.
You almost sound like a Justin Bieber super fan.
It's crazy.
I'm a fan of the film. I think clearly the film presents him as quite talented.
Let's see the trailer as much as we can stomach it.
It's not gonna be in 3D.
Oh no.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Well, that's part of what's good about it.
If you're at home and you have 3D glasses on, put them
on.
That's
right. Just imagine that when Bieber is doing this, he's actually reaching out to you. That's right.
All right, let's see it.
My name is Justin. This is how I go.
I've been a fan of him from when he posted his first video, and I'll be his fan till he posts his last video.
You hear these stories how tough it is for adults.
He's 16, and he's doing it all on his own.
The first time we met, he almost passed me by. Thought you'd always be
He's such an inspiration. He came from, like, such a small town, and it gives us hope.
I think to myself, I was once chilling in my room, just in a regular place, and now I'm in this big world. It's just crazy how it all came around.
He's living an extraordinary life, but it's just like you or me.
This is supposed to be the best.
It is.
It's one of the best films of the year.
It is. It's one of the best films of the year.
It's a very serious show.
I know.
Well, I'll take your word for it that it is.
Thank you.
So I'm going to go see it immediately after we wrap up the show.
I agree. I think you're just worried that it's going to, like, you know, hurt your cred with the indie rockers in your life. Yeah.
The Dockerati.
The Dockerati.
Bring your own Dockerati. I just think that one thing that's really incredible about film is its power to impact people and culture and society and even the law sometimes. And I think it's important to note Paradise Lost 3 for that, as opposed to Justin Bieber. No offense to Justin Bieber, but maybe it will cause 13-year-olds to create their own videos, you know,
sure,
from now on. Maybe it'll inspire 13-year-old kids to give it all up and not pursue a college education and not go for a president. And
well, if you can sell as many records as Justin Bieber, I would recommend you do.
Quit school.
Yes.
This is coming from our lawyer.
It's common sense.
Musician, rapper, come lawyer,
right,
I might say. So you always had a backup in your pocket.
This
you were like,
true,
okay, law school.
I did.
Like, I'll have that in the side.
Yeah.
Yeah. And now he can, like, actually, we actually had a show in development, like, in the early 90s where he was, it was called Hip Hop Court. And I wanted to do this show where it was like the People's Court, but Vlad would be the lawyer and he would, like, rap it out. Wouldn't that be awesome?
That would be awesome.
It would be just dealing with urban issues and Vlad would come out and be like, say it. You're on.
Well, we'll save it for another show.
Oh, it's all about extemporaneous, isn't it, in your world?
It is.
anyway, Paradise Lost 3, Joe Berlinger and Bruce Sanofsky, who made Paradise Lost and Paradise Lost 2, also on your list for powerful films of the year. Why?
Well, I mean, clearly, for those who are familiar with the case, Paradise Lost drew a lot of attention to the case of the West Memphis Three teenage boys that had been arrested and convicted of a really heinous crime of three murders of young boys just outside of Memphis in Arkansas. It became a case that, as in the first film in particular, and then going into the second film, if anything was clear, it was that there was no way they should have been convicted based on the evidence that was presented, and that there was plenty of conflicting evidence that would tend to exonerate them. And because of the film, a lot of people got interested in the case, some celebrities, and a lot of just regular folk who took it upon themselves to continue to push for an appeal, for the case, the verdicts to be overturned. One of the boys was on death row.
Right.
Damien, who also was railroaded in because he wore black and because he drew, you know, drawings that were considered occult.
And listened to heavy metal music.
He was considered a Satan worshiper.
They had a PhD to testify in court that he was somehow a Satan worshiper because he wore black. And then it turns out the guy didn't have a PhD, where he had a PhD, but it was like a mail-in PhD, like a mail-order PhD or something like that.
Yeah.
I mean, it was really kind of, it was what comes up again and again, where people have this need to know what happened, to be able to say, okay, case closed, you know,
right.
And I think that really causes, but as Damien himself has said, you know, it happens all the time. You know, this is like, the justice system.
They just got, you know, the attention. But the thing about this particular film, so it's an unusual thing in documentary that it's a trilogy, it's a sequel, you know, to a sequel.
Right, to a sequel.
Yeah, and so when you go into it, my feeling was, well, what's gonna be
different
in this that we haven't seen? And what they've done, which I think is actually really terrific, is that they basically have constructed a film in part from footage that they didn't use the first two times. But if you know nothing about the case, they sort of rebuild the entire storyline for you in the third film. And so it becomes, I wish they hadn't even called it Paradise Lost 3, because it's a film in and of itself. It tells the whole story, it's complete. You don't need to know anything going in. And then, of course, it ends, and spoiler alert, but the boys, who are now obviously 30-year-old men.
They've been in for 18 years.
Yeah, they have now been released from prison under a very controversial plea deal. But the film, so the film has this whole story, and it's been shortlisted for the Academy Awards.
Which there's some controversy about that, because parents of some of the children that were murdered are complaining.
Of one of the boys,
correct.
But that's not even, I mean, it's not even about the parents. It's just interesting that, you know, there's other controversy around it, which is our next episode in January. We're going to be seeing our friend Amy Berg, who you probably know also pretty well,
great
filmmaker, who is making a film about the exact same topic. So this is four films now about these three boys.
And there's a narrative film in the works that Adam McGoyan is directing, and supposedly Reese Witherspoon is going to star in. This was just recently announced. So there's obviously a lot of interest in the case. It's hard for me to see another documentary made on this subject. So
it's premiering at Sundance.
Yes.
It's called West of Memphis, I believe.
Yes.
We're going to talk to Amy about it
next episode.
But it is strange because it was sort of Joe's thing. Like, that was what Joe was doing.
There's really
or
no...
It wasn't really Joe. Sheila Nevins gave Joe an article. And then Joe and Bruce and said, check this out. And she's done that to me. That's how I ended up in Iowa.
Yeah.
You know, here's an article. Three judges were ousted, you know. Here's an article. 3 8-year-old boys were found in a river.
Right.
Can you go figure, you want to go check it out? You know, at that point they had done, I think, My Brother's Keeper, so.
Sure.
But that became something that was theirs, and so, but it's funny because I'm looking at it through that lens as I watch Paradise Lost 3, and it's funny because Joe and Bruce work themselves into the footage like they've never done before. Kind of almost saying, okay, well, if this is going to be our final film, we're going to make sure everybody knows we made this film. this is our trilogy. Did you look at it through that lens, or did you see it before knowing this?
Yeah, I had no idea. Like, this news of the last one, which took me totally by surprise, I had no idea it was being made. So
it's Peter Jackson producing, actually.
Yeah.
Lord of the Rings.
Yeah.
Never know, you know. I mean, maybe it'll be a different view. I wonder.
It's just, you know, they just haven't said anything so far that gives you any indication that their take on it is going to be drastically different than the three films that Joe and Bruce have made. And in fact, they try to claim that they haven't seen the films in some cases, even though Peter Jackson says that he was inspired to make a documentary on the case because he watched a documentary on the case.
Just not that documentary.
It's just weird.
Yeah.
It is strange, and it's interesting in this genre that is our lives in the documentary world to see that kind of clamoring happening, like to see any kind of drama like that. Well, it's not usual, you know.
Yeah. And they're actually talking about the fact that they're going back and exploring the case itself. So it's not just as if they didn't know that Joe and Bruce were making a third film, which was going to bring everyone up to date, and they were catching everyone up from the first film.
Actually, I think they said that they started the film because Damien hadn't seen Joe and Bruce for many, many years. That's what I heard. And that like it had been a decade or something since Joe and Bruce had been down there, so then they actually contacted Peter Jackson or Damien knew Peter or something, and Damien's actually producing the other film, which is very strange.
Which also calls into question what the nature of a producer is.
Right.
Because
perhaps.
How do you produce?
From behind bars.
Yeah. I don't know. It's just, I mean, it would be as if somebody came out tomorrow and said, like, you know, I have this amazing film I'm going to make about the relationship between the Dandy Warhols and Brian Jonestown Massacre, and, like, I'm just going to, like, really explore this in a documentary.
Can I have your footage for a book? I'm going to make a coffee table book. And I'm like, well,
that's at least another medium, you know. Yeah. I mean, this is someone, and if someone said to you, the reason I want to make this film is because I saw this great documentary, Dig. And so I think I should make a documentary about the subject. It's just bizarre.
I think it's not about that, because Peter Jackson doesn't need the money or the acclaim. What I think he was doing was trying to use a film to get them out, probably when it started.
It's a personal cause.
Yeah, at some point, we should just have them both on the show.
Good idea.
But we'll start with Amy, because we're doing a Sundance special edition, and they did select the film for Sundance, so we'll start with her at the beginning of the new year.
But let me just kind of throw in one more thing, which you know...
It is the interweb. You may as well.
It's a topic that, you know, that speaks to, is the nature of a talented filmmaker being hired by a very powerful executive producer to come in and make a film about something and then basically not really knowing at that point who the film is by. And it seems to me that this, you may know something about this, has you know, an interesting thing that has happened recently, where we see more cases where people who are very talented filmmakers and have their own rights and their own skills, and then like somebody else comes in and people
were
like,
"Yeah, here's work for hire." You're just talking about work for hire.
Is it Amy's film? Is it Peter's?
I think we should have actually. I mean, and this is speaking to the doc side, as we call it. It's the business side of the business.
Yeah.
And I think we should take a walk on the doc side.
Yeah.
And I think we should dedicate a show or shows to talking about work for hire.
Good idea.
At least one. Because it's very serious what's happening in documentary with that.
Right.
I mean, directors more and more are hired almost to go out and do the, you know, do the foot soldier work.
And be the credible face.
Be the credible face.
Standing at the front of it.
Yeah.
And then what happened?
As you know, I had a terrible, terrible time with Cool It regarding that. And I don't have a gag order on it or anything like that. So I can just say it straight out. I mean, I was very passionate about the film. And I love Roadside Attractions and Bjorn Lundberg. And I believed in his ideas. But I took a work for hire assignment. And I lost 3 months of sleep between the time we got into Toronto and premiere and the theatrical release. With them recutting it, firing our whole staff, like, but my name's still being on it. It's very hard to get your name off.
Yeah.
So yeah, there's definitely a conversation to be had.
And I don't know.
I hate to end the show on such a depressing note.
Well, I don't know, and I shouldn't say, because I don't know that, you know, that it's a controversial case in terms of that with between Peter Jackson and Amy Berg. But it was interesting when it was all presented as, you know, Peter Jackson's made this documentary, but then you read the material on it, and clearly they had hired Amy. Amy's a very talented Oscar-nominated filmmaker.
Oh, really? There was a thing that just gave Peter all the credit?
Yeah. So who's, you know, and then Peter says in the interviews, like, I didn't have time to make this. I'm off doing The Hobbit.
Peter's in it.
Well, anyway, I haven't seen the film.
How do we wrap this up, honey?
It's maybe let's wrap it up by summarizing what we want you guys to go out there and see. I mean, you should go see Kurt Cobain About His Son, of course.
Clearly.
On Christmas.
Definitely, if you can, get your hands on Buck.
Paradise Lost 3, Project Nim, and see Paradise Lost 3. It's a really great watch.
It is.
I mean,
yeah.
It really is.
It'll be on HBO in mid-January, have its premiere on HBO.
And don't forget about The Interrupters.
Yeah.
Don't forget about that. Boy Meir, 10 years.
Also.
I'm sorry?
The Interrupters will be on Frontline in February.
Okay, fabulous. The Boy Meir, 10 years in Afghanistan, is an amazing story about a family that has been displaced by the Taliban and live inside the rocks in Afghanistan. And this British filmmaker, I forget his name actually, but you can look it up on the internet, who went in there and just kind of visited this boy over a 10-year period. And you know me, I'm a sucker for 10-year projects. So I love this. I really love seeing the way that you think of, you know, Afghanistan, or I do. And I love when my stereotypes are just sort of blown to bits, you know? And I had a very much an image of them, you know, where the woman is very much respectful of the man and quiet and always has her head covered. And it's just so funny, the verite of footage of the way that this woman talks to her husband. You idiot, get out there and get the wood. And it's really funny.
Awesome.
So there's a lot of humor to be gained in that. And it's also, it's interesting to look inside a culture that we look at very much two-dimensionally and see all of the different characters and the humanity and the little small fights and victories that happen in a single family. Senna.
Senna's
fantastic,
great.
Right?
All constructed from archival material.
Amazing. Great editing.
Incredible editing.
Yeah.
Bill Cunningham, New York,
Yep, delightful. It's another great portrait film about a really interesting character and one of the most entertaining docs of the year, for sure.
Your prediction, AJ, for the Oscar nominees?
It's kind of a weird year. There isn't sort of the front runner that you would normally have of the films that we've talked about. Project Nim and Paradise Lost 3 and Buck are all on the short list. Sort of famously, Interrupters and Senna were not on the Academy short list, which is a...
Tell me about when you threw me a bone. You threw us a bone.
Well, you know, the thing is
that
it's a time when, the Academy is clearly defensive about the way the shortlist is put together, and the fact that each year people are unhappy. There was several posts by Academy members on a documentary website that said they were tired of everyone whining. The fact of the matter is that the Foreign Language Committee, after years of controversies, has come up with a system by which the panel comes up with a number of the shortlisted titles, and then there's a blue ribbon committee that steps in at the last minute, looks at that list, and says, if we don't include these three films, we are going to be lambasted.
Right.
And so I think people are now starting to ask, why hasn't the Academy adopted a similar thing for the documentary branch? Why can't the people who are watching the screeners come up with 10 to 12 of the 15 films, and there's a blue ribbon committee that looks at it and says, you know, we can't let, there's no conceivable list of the best 15 films of the year that doesn't include The Interrupters and Senna. And so that I think is something that people will continue to talk about this season. And, you know, unless the Academy is serious about what is, and I'm not a member, but as a documentary filmmaker, it's not good, I don't think, for us that each year the highest honor that is given in our field, the oldest honor that is given in our field, is constantly viewed as being suspect. And it would be much better if the Academy got things under control and came up with a system where this wasn't the situation every year. And whether they want to think that we're all just whining about their choices, I think it would be much better if they actually came to their senses and realized that their system does not produce the best films of the year.
I don't know. I mean, all I know is that we got more press off being snubbed Maybe we would have gotten more press off being off the on the short list, but I remember just so much press, New York Times and everything, when We Live in Public was snubbed.
Yeah.
Dig was disqualified. There's always a reason why I'm not there. And maybe it's that they don't like me.
Well, I mean, I think it is up also their bias about portrait films of, you know, and even well-made ones, and traditionally, like, it's more difficult for them to.
I was asked to play We Live in Public at the Academy, and I went down there on April 20th this year, and I said I was surprised to be invited down here considering you didn't feel that we were even shortlistable, and they said actually it was really controversial within the Academy that We Live in Public wasn't shortlisted. It was actually. Most members had a problem with the main character. They didn't like him. They didn't like Josh Harris. Yeah. I'm like, well, that's really strange, because you'd think that in a body of filmmakers and people that are deemed, you know, the end-all be-all judges of film,
right.
They would look past the main character to the actual film, or look at the fact that the film is about a main character that is a cautionary tale, and that's the point of the film.
Right.
You know, it's very strange, but.
You know, I mean, everyone's always going to be people who are unhappy, and I think that, you know, that's the thing that they keep sort of, like, excusing the list with, is like, well, we're never going to satisfy everyone. But the problem is, you know, there's too many cases where you look at the films of the year, and there's another probably 15 films that could have been included, and people would have been perfectly happy about them, including Nostalgia for the Light, which won the IDA Award, Position Among the Stars, The Arbor, Dragon Slayer, Bombay Beach. There's Tabloid, Cave of Forgotten Dreams. I mean, there's a ton of really great work
that was not
shortlisted. So it's not just really about these two films.
But you started your own. I mean, you actually founded an awards show for a documentary called Cinema Eye Honors.
I did.
Which we all vote on,
yes.
Right? We, the community. That's pretty amazing. When did you start that? 2 years ago? 3 years ago?
This is the fifth year in January.
Okay. I'm behind the
times. We're just getting old. That's fine. Yeah.
That's amazing. Time flies.
It does fly.
I do remember you founding it.
Yeah.
So that's another contribution you've made. Here, AJ. Here's to AJ.
Here's to AJ.
Okay, AJ. When are the nominations going to come in? When should we have you back?
The nominations are already for the Oscars.
Yeah.
Will be out, I think, in mid to later January. I don't know the exact.
Maybe you can come on or Skype in.
Sure, we'll do whatever.
And give us
I'll send smoke signals, carrier pigeons.
Something.
Yeah.
Give us a message.
For
Maybe
sure.
We'll read a message from you.
Indeed.
Here's AJ's thoughts on it.
Yeah.
Since you're not blogging anymore, give you an outlet here on the show.
I appreciate it.
Yeah.
I need one. I might just explode from all my pent-up doc feelings.
I know. Well, we'll have you. Just give us a buzz
all
when
right.
you need to come on.
Oh.
All right, everybody. That brings us to the conclusion of our special holiday episode of BYOD. That's our year-end wrap-up.
I'd like to say Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah, and if I missed anyone, Happy Holidays.
How about Kwanzaa?
Merry Happy Kwanzaa.
Is it Merry Kwanzaa? Happy Kwanzaa.
No idea.
Okay. Thanks, and have a great holiday season. We'll see you in January.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Happy Holidays.